Yes. Hey, God bless you as you give today.
Prayer is
Leadership. and the godly character that he brings to that board and the heart that he has. Let's give this unto the Lord this morning. You can make your checks out to First Assembly, and we're going to roll all the money in the right one shape to the Father. Thank you today for helping us experience the supernatural of the kingdom of God. Lord, I just believe that you're going to continue to pour out your spirit in this service until your will is done, until what you want to happen happens. Father, I just thank you right now for Gene and Mona. I thank you for the ministry that you've given them and the fruit that they are bearing. And God, we just pray today you'll bless our people as we invest in this ministry and in things eternal. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you as you give. I'm going to turn the service back to our evangelist. Would you welcome him? He's just going to preach this morning whatever God's laid on his heart.
Thank you, Pastor. Sincerely, Reverend Pastor, what a brilliant church to reach out and touch these people to lead you for these several years now. And I thank him. We've had ministry that dates back to the time that he literally arrived here. And I thank the Lord for that. We certainly don't take that for granted. I will tell you this, I used to have a real job and pastor for 25 years. Thank you for those looks. And I would hear evangelists come, and by the time they got through explaining why they were there, they were almost apologizing for taking space up in the building. And the entire time I would listen to them introduce the revival, there was no fire that was in anything that they had to say. I could see my revival spiraling out of control. I said, Lord, if you ever put me in that position, I will never do that to the man of God that leads that church. I got to tell you, I came to this place to bring revival this week. Amen. I mean that with all of my heart. It has probably nothing to do with my calling, but it has everything to do with the anointing. So we trust that the Lord is going to meet with us. It really touches my heart to hear a pastor pull for people to come and be in extended meetings on Sunday night, Monday and Tuesday, Wednesday night, when honestly I know that that is literally the least that we can do for the kingdom's sake and for ourselves to build up our most holy faith. I believe that. So you come and be in these meetings and because you know what will happen. The first time you miss one of the services, whether it be tonight, tomorrow night, or Tuesday or Wednesday, two things are going to happen. Number one, it's going to be the night that you know that you really missed something. You really needed to be there in attendance. And the other thing is we're going to talk about you. That got your attention. Amen. I appreciate Mona coming. I will tell you that Mona, she's a full-time wife to me. What a beautiful lady. Some guys thought one time that I was being henpecked. And I told them, I said, have you seen the hen that's pecking me? If y'all saw the girl that I dated before Mona, you'd be proud of this girl. I'll leave it alone. I'll leave that alone. I know what ugly is. I look at this in the mirror every day. When I was a kid, I was so ugly, they used to set me in the corner and feed me with a slingshot. I love Mona. Some guys got me a book one time and said, I want you to read this book. And it's talking about self-assertion and how that if you're going to be lord over your wife, you need to be more self-assertive. And these guys bought me this book, and I read that book. One day when I closed that book, I looked at Mona and I said, hey, you know what? I'm the ruler of this household. You may not know it, but I want you to cook my meals. You're going to wash my clothes. And I went on about a 10-minute rant of how she's supposed to serve me. And I said, by the way, tomorrow morning, do you know who's fixing my hair? She said, my guess would be the undertaker. So I put up my self-assertive book, and I decided to be just like you men, serve my wife. That's right. Thank you for those looks. If you have the Bibles, go to Lamentations. Lamentations, the first chapter. I love visiting with you. We'll do more of that as the week goes on. Lady over in Memphis, Tennessee, ran up to Mona and said, I want to go up there and look at his script. And Mona looked at it and said, do what? She said, that script, all that humor he does. And Mona looked at her and said, no, honey, he's just full of it. There's no script. Amen. Lamentations, the first chapter. How doth the city sit solitary that was full of people? How has she become as a widow, she that was great among the nations and princes among the provinces? How has she become tributary? She weepeth sore in the night, her tears are on her cheeks. Among all her lovers, she hath none to comfort her. All her friends have dealt treacherously with her. They are become her enemies. Judah is gone into captivity because of affliction and because of great servitude. She dwelleth among the heathen. She findeth no rest. All her persecutors overtook her between the straits. The ways of Zion do mourn because none come to the solemn feast. All her gates are desolate. Her priests sigh. Her virgins are afflicted, and she is in bitterness. Her adversaries are the chief. Her enemies prosper. For the Lord hath afflicted her for the multitude of her transgressions. Her children are gone into captivity before the enemy, and from the daughter of Zion all her beauty is departed. Her princes are become like harts or deer that find no pasture, and they are gone without strength before the pursuer. Jerusalem remembered in the days of her affliction and of her miseries all her pleasant things that she had in the days of old, when her people fell into the hand of the enemy and none did help her. The adversary saw her and did mock at her Sabbaths. Jerusalem hath grievously sinned, therefore she is removed. All that honored her despise her, because they have seen her nakedness. Yea, she sigheth and turned backward. Her filthiness is in her skirts. She remembereth not her last end, therefore she came down wonderfully. She had no comforter. O Lord, behold my affliction, for the enemy hath magnified himself. The adversary hath spread out his hand upon all her pleasant things, for she hath seen that the heathen entered into her sanctuary, whom thou didst command that they should not enter into thy congregation. All her people sigh, they seek bread. They have given their pleasant things for meat to relieve the soul. See, O Lord, and consider, for I am become vile. Verse 12 is my text for the day, and I have interjected the word her in this passage. Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass her by? Behold, and see if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. I want to preach for a time this moment. That I would submit to you that this year has grabbed my spirit, and it's all right to use the vernacular, has possessed my soul. I know that many of you have walked in the scriptures year after year. One of my mentors in life would call me and tell me what version of scripture we were going to read as we read through the Bible year after year. But many of you know what I know today, that there are many times as we read the Bible that we find out God is a wonderful writer, and many times we're poor readers. For this passage of scripture that is there, that 13th verse, used to get by me. But I titled this message today, Is It Nothing to You? I would submit to you that that this is a message of self-examination. If there's anything, while the rest of the world seems to be going south and being headed toward the Netherland, I want you to know that many of us in the church city should be crying out to God and saying, what I want to be said of my life is what was said about the prophet Daniel, that he had a more excellent spirit in him. While the rest of the world seems to be going a different direction, let the church be the church and rise up and declare that we are going to be a victorious people, that we are going to live as overcomers in the sight of God. Is it nothing to you? It's a message that reminds me what the Proverbs writer in Proverbs 14 and 34 would declare, that sin is a reproach to any people. And yet, Jerusalem finds this out the hard way, that Jerusalem has sinned, and now God gives her over to and her everything about her advantage to her enemies, the Babylonians. And for 70 years, she is in captivity. And yet, the enemy does more than just defeat Jerusalem. She took every opportunity to embarrass her. And now she would do anything to sustain her people. There's no meat or bread to suffice their children. They're literally starving to death. In verse 11, it would declare that she would take anything of the past. Parents, I don't know about you, I have very little that is left to me. My grandfather, who died many years ago, was born in 1900. And all that's been left to me is a handful of precious silver and a few Confederate dollars that are probably not worth anything. But I promise you, you could not buy them. There is no sum of money. They represent William Benjamin Downs in my life, my grandfather, who took me to see Roy Rogers and Dale Evans at the there in the old Houston Coliseum many years ago. I just tell you, people who have lost homes to hurricanes or to fire and said, would to God that they could have got more than kids' pictures, than heirlooms from the past, and now all of that is devastated and gone. And yet this group of people said, if we would be glad to take anything that had any value to it, and if we could just feed our babies and take care of them. That's in the physical. And now it even looks worse to Jeremiah. In the book of Lamentations, he begins to draw out spiritually that there was a day that a solid stream of people would go to the tabernacle, to the temple, and now no one approaches the doors. In fact, Jerusalem's holy places have been desecrated, and strangers to God rudely inhabit the most holy places. And according to Scripture, when her holy places are desecrated, Jerusalem's beauty is destroyed. And immediately, verse 7 begins to declare to us that Jerusalem begins to grieve and remembers her old days and begins to reminisce about the past when there was a very presence of God among them. She remembers all her sweet and pleasant days. I would submit to you, I don't believe that hell was ever designed for you and I. If you make it to hell, it will be because you made a conscious decision to go there. It wasn't even designed for us. It was designed for Satan and all of his evil little angels. I am telling you, ladies and gentlemen, if you make it to hell, the horrors, the most horror that you will face in hell will not be the flames. That will torment, no doubt. But the worst thing will be for you to have memory that there was a time when you were in the presence of God, and there in hell, there will be no presence of God. Verse 6 declares that her princes, who normally would protect her, no longer has the strength to fight the enemy. There are several of you that are probably my age that remember when we were in junior high school in 1968, 20 years after Israel has
declared her statehood and becomes a nation, that there are those, Saudi Arabia, Egypt. And when you read that passage today, it just tickled me to death to hear that Egypt was thrilled when they left. I tell you, the Saudi Arabia, Jordan, that came out against them. How many of you remember the Six-Day War? And they were showing, man, I had a civics teacher that said, get ready, Israel is going to get her due. She's going down with all of these prosperous nations that had targeted her. And at the end of 6 days, I want you to know, God blessed Israel with a wonderful victory. And all of those other countries went home tucking their tail between their legs. This has been a victorious country, and God has ruled over them for many years. But now it is a picture of utter desolation and total separation from God. This is that once beautiful city that Daniel would pray towards three times a day. This is the city that David danced before the Lord as he entered in with the Ark of the Covenant. There was a day that her beauty was her holiness, but now her sinful nature is in her skirts. Oh, that he knows she cannot do a thing about it. Sits out there in sackcloth and ashes and in pure mourning. And Jeremiah sits there and declares in verse 12, is it nothing to you, all you who pass by, people that pass by, like it's nothing to them that Jerusalem has lost her beauty, people that mock at her, the indignation, the abomination of people going up into the holy places where they had no business going. And this old man sits here and laments and doesn't understand. It seems that nobody cares that there is utter desolation, that they are reeking with sinful nature. I would submit to you, for the sake of this message, that this is an Old Testament look at our modern day church today and the position that our country is in today. Who could ever deny against my preaching this morning and not recognize as many of our churches as well as our country is in disrepair? I want you to give me a little latitude and ask some difficult questions to you today. You know, most of you who know my ministry know that probably the rest of the week I'll spend it down in the aisles and preaching to you. But I don't want to miss one of these. I want you to hear this from the voice of this evangelist. Is it nothing to our church people that abortion is rampant in our nation today? I'm not upset with you, ma'am. Sweetheart, if you had an abortion and God has healed you, you are healed. But I'm telling you, there is still a wrong in this nation today. Something wrong with the people. Sails through your neighborhood, and if a drunk was running to a pregnant woman, they could get him for double homicide if it killed her and her baby. And yet, it's all right for somebody to take the life of an unborn child. We're upside down, people, in a nation. Is it nothing to us that same-sex marriage is acceptable in this nation today? That the mayor of Houston just last year went and traveled to Las Vegas or there to Los Angeles somewhere and married her same-sex partner. Is it nothing to us that history teaches that the three ingredients to the failure of any country is, number one, taxes, second, nudity and immorality, and thirdly, sports and entertainment? Is it nothing to us that we recognize that in the very individual, the goddess Diana, and those followers of her that you can find over in Acts, the 19th chapter, that came against the church in those days, where you find them later, that the goddess Diana, whenever the Lord addresses them in Revelation, the 3rd chapter, and he goes back to that church and declares to them, because you are cold in your spirit, and have needed nothing, I'll spew you out of my mouth. It's none other than the goddess Diana, who is the goddess of sports and entertainment. And it reeks in our society today. The churches where Mo and I go and minister cannot hardly have any extended meetings of any kind in their churches today for sporting events that take place, and it has run rampant through our churches today. Is it nothing to us that at the beginning of our nation's history, that our churches were responsible for starting all the public schools of this nation, and now God is not allowed anywhere on our campuses today? We get mad when people want to declare, where is God when 22 little babies, that's what I call them, little five-year-olds, were killed in Connecticut. And I have a cousin that was raised not far from there, and she said it has devastated them. It has been a spirit of mourning, a spirit of gloom that has hovered over them for the last 2 or 3 years now. And yet, I'll tell you, people want to know where God was. God has not been allowed back in our nation's school system for many years, since Madeline Mary O'Hare. When I was a child raised up in Channelview Schools, just there east of Houston, I can declare to you, every morning we learned to put our hand over our heart and pledge allegiance to the United States of America. We learned the Lord's Prayer at a very young age. But I want you to know that the church has allowed society to come and push us one way and to the next. I would submit to you that the church is not to be the voice of culture. The church is to be the voice of God. We need to stand up against this political correctness that has taken place. Oh, I'm not running for any office. One of our local preachers here and there in the San Antonio area said, you need to leave our politicians alone. They're trying to do the work of two people, Laurel and Hardy. Hold on just a moment. Whitwell, Matt Calvin. Okay. Is it nothing to us that men and women are leaving their spouses and children to live in same-sex relationships? Is it nothing to us that homosexual teachers and pedophiles have been released on our school campuses? There in the metropolis of Houston, Bone and I live further east out in Dayton, Texas, or the Barbers Hill community in Mont Bellevue, Texas. I would submit to you that we hear all the time that it's not just teachers in our school systems, but many times FBI has raided the home of those that would be the superintendents of our schools and the school board members, only to find pedophilia all over the internet and in their personal computers. I would submit to you, friend, that it's a cancer upon society. Is it nothing to us that our youth are more involved in Little League and select sports than youth ministries? Our youth pastors talk to them. We can't give them enough digital help around the church. You can't put enough games in the church for them to be able to attract our kids out of the world, and they're not receiving any of that help at home to be able to come and find out about one that is more exciting than any digital game in their life, that will take them farther than any score that they can put on the screen. His name is Jesus Christ. That was a fear. I remember listening in a revival service that was taking place. I didn't know that a drug dealer had wandered into the place, but by the time the message was through, they got a hold of him in the altars. He got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost, got up and testified to the church that I've been on many highs before, but there is nothing any more exciting than what I have experienced in this church tonight. Is it nothing to us that many of our churches are not the spiritual lighthouse that they used to be? Is it nothing to us that a greater percentage of our churches have lost their power, no longer Pentecostal in their experience? Is it nothing to us that through our weak testimony, America no longer respects the church or the ministries involved in it? Who was it? It was Amos. Amos 6:1 declared, "Woe unto them that are at ease in Zion." Any of us Pentecostal believers that have been believers for very long understand what Paul was writing out of Romans 13:11, and that knowing the time, that it's high time to wake out of sleep. For now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. Matthew 24:12, in the red letter edition, Jesus declares, "And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold." I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, there is an answer to the dilemma that we are in today. I found it there in 2 Chronicles 7:14, that if my people, which are called by my name, God said, if they'll humble themselves and pray and seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Pastor, there was a day that I prayed over the moment I our ministry that God would help me be able to put the adjectives together. I heard Jimmy Swaggart pray years ago that God would help him in his vocabulary. But I don't know, John, that if I am so excited about being an excitable preacher in that pulpit anymore as I am, I don't know if I want you to hear pretty preaching anymore as much as I want you to hear somebody be a man or a woman of God that can stand in that holy desk and tell me the truth. Anointing, grab a hold of us. Anointing, get a hold of us to where people would declare when they got out of the church service, what did he preach about? Say, I don't know, but the Spirit of God bailed him out and bailed the church out, and God moved in the altar services.
Yes. I'm sorry. 2015 maybe it's going to be my great awakening, where I don't want to so much hear the applause at the end of the service as much as I do witnessing people running to altars and throwing themselves on the altar and praying through and saying, God, can we come back to the place of holiness? Holiness exalts a nation. Righteousness exalts a nation. My God. We're in desperate need of revival. Nobody would question that. But my question is, are we hungry enough to pursue all that the Lord is trying to equip us with? Is it worth your time, your talent, and your treasure? I guess those decisions will be made by First Assembly of McAllen in the next four services. Is it nothing to us that we are not the Christian that we used to be? This is nothing to us that souls in many of our churches today, I haven't been here lately, so I don't want to lay that on you, but many of the churches that Mom and I go to, their altars are barren. There's no prayers laid at the altars anymore. A dear friend of mine, black man by the name of Jack Gray, always humored me. His name was Jack Gray. He's a buddy. He offered to buy my lunch. You can see I didn't turn it down. As we were eating Mexican food there in the Houston area on Federal Road, he looked at me and said, "Brother Gene, I won't talk to you. What's wrong with the white church?" I said, "What do you mean, Jack? What do you mean? Well, what's wrong with the white church?" He said, "Well, in the white church, something got to be wrong with you to go to the altars." I said, "Really?" He said, "Yeah. In the black church, something wrong with you. You don't go to the altar." Oh my. The way you're shouting out. Is it nothing to us that our spirit is so cold,
Our church is not experiencing the growth and such a growth that it should spur a last day revival. My God, doesn't anybody care? Is it really possible that the enemy has put us in his rocking chair and said, we've got enough, I have a buddy, we can go preach a revival in one of our cities. And the pastor, when he put Brother Rob Benson in the seat with him, he said, look, this week, you just preach your candy sticks. That's what he told me. Just don't get excited. You're going to be well taken care of. We had an old saint passed away here, left us millions of dollars. So it just doesn't matter. When Brother Rod got to that church, many of the wings of that church, they've been roped off. So everybody would sit in the center aisle. Church would seat over 500 people. And on Sunday morning, there wasn't 50 folks to show up and say amen. I'm going to tell you, church, it's a crying shame when our pastors have to start begging us and crying on our shoulder to have us come and show up and be faithful in the house of God. When my daddy was pastoring, my dad, man, that bunch, you remember how tough they were on us? Man, you get caught writing a note in church. Oh, Katie barred the door. Are you kidding? Our pastor, Gordon Gibson, could call me and my brother Russell. Russell's 17 months younger than I am. And boy, we get to goof it off. Why we did that on the front row, I don't know. But Pastor Gordon Gibson would shut us down. Gene, Russell, y'all shut up. And he would never miss a note. Just keep right on going. But if I heard that noise back there about six rows back. It was Joy Summers, my mom. And it sounded, when she did that, it sounded like a high-powered rifle going off. I nudged Russell and say, don't you look back, I'll kill you, because if you look back, she's going to kill both of us. Buddy, I'll tell you, she would give you that old crooked finger to come there, and when you got even with her pew, she wasn't scooting over to let you in. I'm telling you, right off down that aisle, we go it. Only legal time me and Russell ever get in the women's bathroom. Old Russell, I'm telling you, that my mama beat the dog out of us. Bring us back in there. I thought that holiness bunch was a little bit strict on this stuff. Our kids today, they sit there and play those games during church. They can amen you. They hear a message in tongues. I think they could give the interpretation while still doing that messaging on their phones, man. Our assembly of God kids are good. And then here's the big one, Elizabeth. Oh, here's the one. First Sunday out of the month was communion. Remember that? Oh, I love the Eucharist. I love communion. I'll tell you, but my dad was in charge, and man, I always envy the Catholics. I don't know about you, Pastor, but they got them neat little wafers. I thought that was so cool. All we got was saltine crackers. Yeah, they broke them things up, but when Dad would go early to church to get the communion ready, that meant me and Russell didn't get to eat out of a box of Cheerios or Malt-O-Meal. We didn't. We got the horse. We get to church, rather. We was hungry enough to eat a horse and chase a rider. We, after service, we'd see that they were doing communion. We would stack up in children's church and wait on them. And when they'd go in, man, we would wait on them. When they come out, all the leftovers from the door, we literally would go in there and get handfuls of that stuff. But God forbid if you got caught. Oh, if you got caught, it was 30 days in the electric chair. It was bad. I told my dad, I said, my poor dad, are we really going to hell? How many of you ever got caught chewing gum in church? We were broke in the Ten Commandments when I was growing up in church. We didn't have no money. Man, if we were going to chew gum, I
Boy, y'all catch on quick. Men will rustle. We'd have to get that ABC gum already been chewed. And we reach under there, Brother Lee, and I'll take it a little bit. We get caught, and they would blister us. I told my daddy, years later, I said, I never understood you. You guys that were so legalistic about that stuff. And he said, hey, if you ever got caught, I know that a lot of our churches today, Pastor, are multi-purpose buildings. I realize that. But my dad would never allow you in the tabernacle of God's people ever bring a soft drink or bring coffee into the auditorium. It didn't matter if you were an adult, if you were a child, my daddy, hey, get the cat out of here. God would strike you dead. My dad finally told me one day, he said, no, Gene, it's not as legalistic as you think. He said, my fear is that one day the church is going to lapse into a time when we no longer have the fear of God in our hearts. That there is no more do we reverence God's house. No longer do we go listen to the pulpit. God hadn't been down and killed anybody since Ananias and Sapphira. And so we're not worried about whether we pay our tithe, give of our offering, support revival services, or help a missionary get to foreign countries. I'm telling you, ladies and gentlemen, is it nothing to us, all you who pass her by? I hear Jeremiah crying, knowing that he may not be able to change a thing, but he wants to be a voice of one crying in the wilderness. Is it time we pay attention to the state and the shape that the church is in today? Stay with me this morning. Stand with me in soberness and somber that this meeting began with this morning. It concerns me that sometimes we sing these beautiful words, people that have an inspiration. Such an inspiration. This young man leads us. I thank God for him. There's such a heart in him to worship. When we begin to sing those songs, I forgive me, the reason I sit on the front is because I don't want to look around. Pastor, I when I had a real job like you've got, I'd sit on the platform on Wednesday nights, and my heart would get broken because I'd sit there and see the way that the people were acting whenever worship was going on. They were so unplugged, and I had a young man leading worship in those days as well, and he would work so hard. He told me that when he left the United States, he went to Bosnia, Herzegovina. Brother Jason Parnell worked for me 8 years. You worked for me for 8 years, you can go to a foreign field. He said, and whenever he got to Bosnia, Herzegovina, he said he saw people just in true worship. He said it felt so enlightening. He said, I didn't feel like I was in East Texas and had to pour water down on dry leathers to get that old pump working again. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Prime. And I'll tell you, these people come on the platform and they pump and they prime and they pump and they prime. I look at God that through this revival this week, that nobody's going to have to pump and to prime you, that you're going to wake up and realize that we are living in last days, and it's time for us to take the message that Jeremiah has left us with, and we're not going to become unholy vessels. We're going to let an empowerment, an endowment of power of the Holy Ghost settle in upon us this week, and we're going to let the Bible fires burn in our spirit. I want to pray over you, and then I want to give an invitation for some of you to come. Could we pray together? Father, in Jesus' name. Woo!
Praise you, Lord.
God, I've been cognizant of people's time. I paid attention to their time. I've been good to this congregation today. But God, I preached my heart. God has said nothing to us. All of us that pass by ministries of the church.